والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. ما شاء الله. Thank you all for coming. We're here at the University of Life, and that's why it's beautiful and it's apt that the quote-unquote class didn't start on time, because it's a good lesson that you're never outside of the classroom. We had the opportunity to sit with Habib, and for those that were there at the table, that was the lesson. After all, we're at the University of Life. And today's curriculum, today's lesson, like every day's lesson, as Habib said, is know yourself. Allah put us here in this earth. This earth, I mean, listen to the stream outside. And hear the sounds of the birds, and also the sounds of the crying babies. We're here at the University of Life, planet Earth. And we're honored to be here. To be a follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to be a student in the University of Life. And who are the teachers? The Prophet, you said the Prophet and the ulama, yes they are, but why are they the teachers? They're the teachers because they remind us that everything is the teacher. Imam Shafi'i said, they said, how did you get such good character? He said, because everyone was my teacher. Either they were teaching me what to do or what not to do. And it's not just people that are our teachers. Habib Hussein, when I walked in, subhanAllah, I came here 2 years ago and he wasn't here. But Mehdar showed me around and I was just like, subhanAllah, subhanAllah. You guys know Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. I was like, this is like Sufi Willy Wonka, and it's like the Sufi Chocolate Factory everywhere I look. What is this? It's amazing. The first thing I remembered is there's like a big shell. It's like a hot tub. You've seen it up there. It's like a shell. SubhanAllah, I was expecting to see a mermaid taking a mud bath. I wouldn't even be surprised. Here it's like this, nothing will surprise you, mashallah. But you come here. When I came here before and I saw the trees and all these things, and they were beautiful to me, but when I was here with Habib, he explained everything. This tree is from there. He said, you see, when you walk in, there's no gate. Because we're open. We don't own anything. And then he said, you see how there's steps up when you walk in? Because no one just goes straight to the top. In life, you have to step by step. Sometimes you fall down some stairs too, and you have to go back up. And he explained what this meant and what that meant. SubhanAllah, it made me think that everything here has meaning. The creator of this place, of this garden, every plant has a meaning. You may not know the meaning, but don't think it doesn't have meaning. Don't think it doesn't have significance. And it caused me to reflect on the fact that, subhanAllah, Allah is the creator of this cosmos. And everything that Allah created, you think He didn't put meaning in a specific thing? You think there is an intention behind every ant, or every piece of dust, or every grain of sand, or every planet, or every color? No, it all has significance. And it all has meaning. And the goal of the true follower of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to look at everything and look for the meaning. Right? Ayatullah. That this is just the signs of Allah manifesting to us. Allah is speaking to us. And if we're truly followers of the Prophet, then the question is, are we seeing Allah speak to us through everything and through every person and through every day and through every night and through every color and through every sound? Because if we're not doing that, then we can't call ourselves followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The difference between a believer and a non-believer is the believer sees everything and he just sees Allah. He sees meaning. He doesn't see one thing and say, this is multiplicity. No, la ilaha illallah. There is one doer, there is one actor, there is one source. Today we're going to talk about Mawlana Jalaluddin Rumi. Rumi starts his magnum opus, the Masnavi. It's a beautiful poem. He said, listen to the sound of the reed as it tells a tale, complaining of its separation. Anything that's been severed from its home, it yearns for the moment of return. What is Rumi talking about? Has everyone heard a reed flute here? Has everyone heard a reed flute? The Ney. Alhamdulillah, last night we had a performance. We had an amazing, they told me he was one of the best Ney players from Indonesia, and he played. And we listened to him, and subhanAllah. The thing about the Ney is it's very beautiful. But it's also like some instruments, they have a sadness quality. Like a violin, you hear it. It makes you want to cry. It's beautiful, but it's melancholy. It's almost like its beauty is mixed in with the sadness. Mawlana Rumi, just like the great awliya, the true seers, he knows that when you listen to a nay, when you hear an instrument, you're not just hearing an instrument, but you're hearing Allah tell you something. I heard a story that one of the sheikhs, there was a young man and he was driving around a sheikh in the Arab world. And this young man, he was listening to music before the sheikh got in the car. And you know, if you listen to the Arab songs, every song, ya Habibi, right? That's the chorus of every song. So the sheikh got in the car and he thought, oh, I should turn down the music because the sheikh is in the car and it's better. But he decided whatever, he just kept driving. And he was listening to the song, and then he looked over and he saw the sheikh crying. And he said, oh no, I upset the sheikh because I'm listening to this pop music. And he said, I'm sorry, sheikh, should I turn it down? He said, no. He said, listen to this song. He's singing about Allah. He's talking about Ya Habibi, my beloved. He's talking about Allah. He's talking about Rasulullah. That's what he heard. Right? So Rumi, when he heard the reed flute, he heard the call of the human soul for Allah. He heard the desire to return. Because the reed, it grows in the riverbed, mashallah, just like this river here. They grow up and they're cut and then they're taken away and then they're carved into. You carve them holes and then you give them the breath. And then they start to cry. Because you took them away from their homeland. You took them away from the place that they're from. And so they're dead, but then you give them breath, they come back to life. And they cry, they say, bring me back home. That's where I'm from. I'm not from here, this strange world that you brought me to. And Rumi said, ah, this is the human being. We're all the reed flutes. We're the reed bed diaspora. Because we were all in a different world. Right? Amir Suleiman, he said, we're all immigrants here, there's no indigenous. We're all immigrants to planet Earth, right? We're all ETs. We're all extraterrestrials. We're not from Earth. We just have a meat spacesuit. Right? Because we're ruh. Nafas ar-Rahman. Right? Nafas ar-Rahman was blown into Adam, and he came alive. And we're Bani Adam. So we just have these space suits that allow us to be in this world, and you know, like you see the astronaut walking, kind of strange, trying to get used to it, and then you see a little kid walking, kind of strange, trying to get used to it. Now we got used to it, we can walk on this planet, but this is not where we're from. We can only breathe the air with our space suit. When we take off our body, we have to leave. and go back to where we're from. So Rumi says, the human being is from a different world. We're from a river, and that's the river of Alastu bi Rabbikum. When we were in the presence of Allah. And this is not just a different world, but it's the perfect world. It's the world that our soul is created from. And we were not just in, when you say Alastu bi Rabbikum, right, in the Quran, there's a plane in which all the souls were, and we were witnessing Allah. But don't just think you just look at Allah, but looking at Allah is the most, the greatest ecstasy you could ever imagine. Right? You think all these, the rivers of Jannah, and the Hur Ain, and the all the palaces and these things, those are nice for a while, but then when Allah removes His veil and you see Allah, khalas, everything else disappears. That's the true Jannah. That's the Jannah of Jannah. Jannah's Jannah is Allah. And we're from that place. And Allah, in His infinite wisdom, knew that there's a reason that we all have to be taken out of that place to experience something different. This is the test. This is the world of test. So Allah said, Alastu bi Rabbikum, am I not your Lord? And we all said, Bala shahidna. We said, yes, we bear witness. And it's interesting, as the Habib said, we said we. We didn't say I. We said we. And that acknowledges that we knew about each other. We all were a community in that space. We were one. We bear witness. Nahnu shahidna. And then we were taken out of that realm and we were brought into this world. Right? We came through the portal of our mother's womb. Right? We came towards the light. We didn't want to leave our mother's womb. We said, we want to stay. But she said, no, it's better for you to go out. So like those souls in the plane of Alastu bi Rabbikum, we want to stay. But Allah said, no, it's important. You have to come out. There's a reason. Hikmah. You don't have to understand it. Right? Even the angels might not understand it. Will you create one who will shed blood and discord on earth? You know not what I know. Even beings of pure light, they don't understand the wisdom that it makes. But Allah knows. So here we come, and just like the reed flute crying when it comes to this world, the baby comes out crying, wailing. Everyone else is smiling when the baby's born because they know this is beautiful. But the baby itself is crying. So this crying is the desire to return back to the world of the plane of Alastu bi Rabbikum. Some people don't remember that world. Most people don't. Some people don't know it, but everyone is an instrument, a musical instrument, and they're playing out the song of their desire to return, whether they know it or not. Some songs are beautiful. You hear them, some people, they're so beautiful, you say, Allah. You know, you see them, you remember Allah. You remember that this world is not all there is. You just see them, they talk. But some people, their song is not so beautiful. Maybe they forgot. Maybe they don't know what they miss. But they feel they're absent something. They're missing something. That's why everyone is yearning for Allah. But they don't necessarily know they're yearning for it. They may fill it with something else. Right? Again, Amir Suleiman, he said the same thing that pulls the fiend to the pipe, the drug addict to the pipe, is the same thing that pulls the human being to the light, the love of love. So some people, we're all desiring to transcend ourselves, right? That me, me, me. It gets tiring, always me, me, me. My wants, my hopes, my fears, my desires. People want to transcend that. So there's different ways. Some people transcend that through going to the discotheque. Just for 1 hour, 2 hours, they forget themselves. They dance to the music. They dance with someone, it's fun, they drink, they don't think, all those thoughts in their head, they just vanish. They're trying to get away from themselves, they're trying to, really they're seeking fana. How can I get beyond myself? Some people do it in going to the football match. For 5 minutes they say, yeah, my team, my team. They forget themselves, they're just totally fana in the game. Some people do it in music, dance, entertainment. You go to a movie, you get caught up in a story. Oh my God, it's so beautiful. Oh, it's so scary. Whatever. But whatever people are using to fill that gap, really what they're seeking for is Allah. And that's why one of the beautiful things, there was a man, he used to be a heroin addict, then he became Muslim. Hardcore drugs. But he said, you know, a religious person is someone who doesn't want to go to hell. But a spiritual person is somebody who's been to hell and doesn't want to go back. So sometimes we all have to go off the path. The best people are the ones that go off. Sometimes the best people are the ones that go off, because when they come back, they know what the other path has to offer. There's no doubt. Some people that have been good their whole life, they think, oh, maybe it would be fun if I did this, or if I go to the club, or if I... But the people that experience all that, they said, I know what it offers. It doesn't fill me. It doesn't draw me. Me, I mean, my whole family is non-Muslim, so I go, they're all drinking alcohol, dinner, and I don't desire, no temptation. I know what it's like to be drunk. It's nothing. I say, the liquor made me sicker, but the dhikr made me drunk. Once you get this, Mawlana Rumi, he says, look, he said, Jesus was riding on a donkey. And Jesus was drunk on Allah. And the donkey was drunk on barley. What's he getting at? Rumi's amazing because everything he says is a symbol. And really all his poetry is a commentary on the Quran. But he's saying all the things, all the stories in the Quran, don't think it's in history. Right? It's in you. So when you hear about Fir'aun, don't think of, oh, this terrible man back. No, there's Fir'aun in you. That's what you need to worry about. So when he says Jesus, what is Jesus? Ruh, Ruh Allah, right? He's the spirit from God. So we all have Ruh min Allah as well. So we all have Jesus. So for Rumi, Jesus is a symbol of the spirit. So he said, you're Jesus, you're that spirit in you, it's always drunk on Allah. That's the only thing that will fulfill it. Yeah? But we also have a donkey inside. Right? The nafs al-amara bisu. That lower self that's drunk. The barley, it's like they think it's like the lowest of things. It's the cheapest. The donkey is satisfied with just barley. So Rumi's saying, don't just be satisfied with barley. In other words, he's not just saying, haram. Don't drink alcohol, don't do this, don't do that. But he's saying, look, upgrade your intoxicants. There's better quality intoxicants than that. In fact, Rumi's very funny. He's funny. Do you think a sheikh can't be funny? MashaAllah, Habib, he proved, you know. In fact, this is my observation. Real people of Allah, they're always funny. You notice this. If ever there's someone, he's a sheikh, he has no sense of humor, I say, oh, he's a fake sheikh. Because who gets upset? Who's uptight? The nafs, the ego. So someone who they're over their ego, you could call them names, it doesn't bother them. It's only the ego that says, you called me a name. You didn't kiss my hand. You're not having adab with me. That's the nafs. The ruh says, mashallah, who am I? So it's always a good sign. You want to know if someone's really spiritual? See if they tell a joke. No, no. So this is the thing. Upgrade your intoxicant. Rumi told a joke. He said, look, if you're going to fornicate with a princess. Don't just fornicate with anyone on the street. In other words, he's telling a joke, but he's saying, have high himmah. Have high himmah. And when Rumi talked, he knew in those days, right? You didn't have YouTube, you didn't have, mashallah, television, you didn't have movie theaters. So what did people do at night? They came to the masjid to listen to the speakers. So Mawlana Rumi, he had his murids, he had his students that really studied with him, but then he had many people off the street. People who have shops or people that have, they're farmers, not necessarily educated. So he knows he can't just be like, everything. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He has to make people speak to people, everyone. So he tells jokes. He says stuff like this. He talked about wine a lot, right? We think he's talking about wine, but he said, I'm not talking about this worldly wine. He said, wine is the spirit of the awliya. Wine is the futuhat, the nafahat, the spiritual breezes that Allah gives you when you're sincere and you purify your heart. Then Allah is like the bartender. He pours in your cup. What is the cup? Your heart. He uses this type of language. And so people laugh. They say, oh, that's funny, the Shaykh is saying that. So he's telling his students, don't be up so uptight. And he's telling the people that are off the street, he said, don't worry. He's speaking to people where they're at. And that's why Rumi, he lived in Anatolia, what's now Turkey. But in his time, it was newly Muslim. So there was a lot of non-Muslims, Christians, Zoroastrian, you know, Central Asian, like shamanic type people. They would come to his gatherings. He knew he had to speak in a language that was universal. He couldn't just say, so he spoke in a universal language. And he also knew the Muslims were new to Islam. So they had different cultures and they had different beliefs from before that they still had mixed with Islam. So he had to speak in a way that spoke to them. And this is one of the secrets that Rumi is still so popular now across the world, non-Muslims. In America, he's the number one selling poet in America. It's amazing. If you have an event talking about, you know, Islam, no one wants to come, only Muslims. But you talk about Rumi, everyone wants to come. This is our legacy. And he was a great wali, and we're going to talk a little bit about his life. But he really lived Islam. And he spoke in many symbols. So we talked about the reed. That's a great allegory. And it's a beautiful allegory, but there's one that's even more perfect. And this one is the one that we actually got from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rumi also uses it. And that's the allegory of the dream. The dream. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, man is sleeping, and when he dies, he wakes up. So here we are. If we believe in him, then we believe, okay, we're sleeping. So this is a dream. And he also said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, die before you die. In other words, wake up before you wake up. It's like the Sufis are the impatient ones. They want to wake up before they die. It's okay, I want to wake up now. I get it's a dream, now I have to wake up, you know. They say like lucid dreamers, you know. People that realize they're dreaming in the dream. You ever had one of that? That's what it is to really be a Muslim. You know, is to realize you're dreaming. There's certain dreams you wake up, you say, oh, I'm dreaming, but you're still in the dream. Then it becomes really fun. It's an interesting dream. Someone who's a non-Muslim, all that really means is they don't realize they're in a dream. They think it's totally real. But the Muslim is supposed to be the one who says, look, it's a dream. The Prophet ﷺ also said, worship Allah as if you see Him. And if you don't see Him, know that He sees you. So if we were to put that, and that's the definition of ihsan, right? Hadith Jibril. So if we're to put that and put it with the other two about dreaming and sleeping and waking, we could poetically say, live this dream as if you're awake. And if you're not awake, know the awake is watching you dream. And in that sense, I want to invite you, I'm going to do a really short exercise. You don't have to move, you don't have to do anything. All you have to do is close your eyes and take a deep breath. Everyone just close your eyes just for a second. Now imagine that you're in a beautiful garden. And the garden is incredibly beautiful and it's warm. It's a warm summer day. But there's a nice cool breeze that's keeping you cool. And the trees are in bloom and there's blossoms of every color. And the smell is fragrant. And there's bees buzzing, pollinating the flowers. And everything is perfect. And you're there with your beloved. And it's so beautiful, and it's so calm, and it's so tranquil, and it's so peaceful that you sit beneath a tree. And you lay in your beloved's lap. And it's so peaceful that you're completely at rest. And you start to drift into sleep. And as you drift off into sleep, you begin to dream. And in this dream, you meet people, you have experiences, you experience hope and pleasure and pain and joy. You see wondrous things and beautiful things and frightening things and confusing things. And very soon, just like we each do every night, you forget about the garden. And the dream becomes your reality. It becomes everything there is. And you drift deeper and deeper into sleep. Now the thing is, you're still there in your beloved's lap. But you've forgotten all about the beloved and the lap and the garden. But every once in a while, your beloved sees that you've fallen deep into this dream and you have forgotten about the garden. And perhaps the beloved sees you going through a nightmare in fear in your dream state. And so the beloved, having mercy on you, the beloved doesn't want to wake you up because the beloved knows there's wisdom in sleep. And you went to the dream world for a reason. You have to rest. But the beloved wants to remind you that it's just a dream. So the beloved maybe takes a flower, a beautiful fragrant rose, and puts it just before your nose. And all of a sudden you get a scent of the garden. And all of a sudden, though you're in this dream or you're in this nightmare, you're in this difficult experience, you remember, wait a second. This isn't all there is. You get this feeling, this intuition, there's something more than this. And perhaps you start to awaken a little bit. And perhaps then you float deeper into the dream. And perhaps another time you're in a dream and you're having great pleasure and great joy. But the beloved also wants to remind you, even the pleasure and the joy, that's just a dream. So again, the beloved will give you a little flower before your nose. And you'll catch this nefahat, this sweet breeze, and you'll say, this isn't all there is. As beautiful as this dream may be right now, my soul yearns for another place. I remember something else. And eventually, when we're ready, we'll all wake up. So if you want, you can open your eyes now. The reason why this symbol, why this allegory is even more perfect than the reed bed analogy is because the dreamer is in the dream. But the dreamer never actually leaves the garden. Right? Just like when you're sleeping at night, whatever crazy world you go through, deep levels of dream, like the movie Inception, right? Dream within a dream within a dream. You never actually leave your bed. You're just right there. Now the reed, it has to get cut and physically leave the reed bed. But we, the secret of Bani Adam, is that the plane of Alestu Birabbikum, this is a time out of time. This is before time. And so by definition, before time, there can't be a before and after. So we've never actually left the divine presence. We're still there. We just fall asleep. and we think we're just in this world. So the prophets and their true inheritors, the awliya, those are the ones that wake up. They open their eyes in the garden. They're still in the dream, but their eyes are also open in the garden, and they're looking at the beloved. And this is why when you're with the people of Allah, when you're with the awliya, subhanAllah, you feel like you're in the garden. It's like their heart, and this is the case. The heart has two doors. One door is to the world, this world. But the inside door of the heart, it opens to Jannah. It opens to the Divine Presence. It opens to Allah. So that's why they say you have to go into khalwa, because you have to close this door, right? You close the eyes, you close the ears, the mouth, right? Because all these are rivers. You have to close them for that other door in the heart to open. But once it's open, it's not going to close. So then you can come out into the world and both doors will be open. So it's like a window then. It's not even a door. It's just an open window. So when you're with the awliya, you feel the breezes from Jannah. They're coming through the window and you're like, subhanAllah, where am I? It's like time stops. Yeah, may Allah surround us with these people. Rumi says, come to the orchard in spring. There is light and wine and sweethearts in the pomegranate flowers. If you do not come, these do not matter. If you do come, these do not matter. The secret of the garden is the beloved that is present in the garden. And that's why Imam Ghazali radiallahu anhu, he says, for the common people, Jannah is what we talk about, the gardens and these type of things. He said, but for the elite, the arifin, Jannah is just the Divine Presence, witnessing Allah. But don't think you ever get tired of witnessing Allah. Some of the philosophers said, no, you can't actually see Allah, because then you, once you see something, you get tired of it, right? You see something, and then you're like, oh, okay, I saw that. But no, Imam Ghazali said, no, don't think it's like that. Allah is not like that. Because every moment, you witness Allah more fully, forever. And it never ends. It's like an ocean, you dive, you know, has anyone done snorkeling? And you see the great reef and all the fish and all the colors. You go deeper and deeper. It gets more amazing. But you keep going deeper, there's no bottom. The bottom never comes. With Allah. It's more amazing at every moment. That's why Allah says in the garden, right? Every bite of fruit, it gets more delicious. It's the opposite in this world. The first bite, so good. Second bite, so good. Third bite, it starts, you don't even taste it anymore, right? SubhanAllah. In Jannah, it's the opposite, right? And witnessing Allah, it gets more amazing every moment. SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. That's why they say the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? He said, Astaghfirullah, 70 times a day. But why? You've never sinned. What's, will Allah forgive? They say, he said that because every day he was elevating a different maqam. Allah was raising him, and so he would say, Astaghfirullah, for the maqam that he was at before. Because he would go higher and see Allah more fully. SubhanAllah. So the question is, right? Okay. Say we accept, okay, we're asleep, okay. But why aren't we awake? Why isn't everyone awake in the garden? That's the question, right? How do we wake up? Well, the secret is, the only reason we're not awake is because of our nafs, our ego. That's the only reason we're not awake. Rumi said, if you could get rid of yourself just once, the secret of secrets would open up to you. The face of the unknown hidden beyond the universe would appear on the mirror of your perception. As we all know, the greater holy war, the greater jihad, is the battle of the self. And Rumi talks a lot about the self. And he always uses this interplay between the self and the self, like the false self and the real self. And that's why أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين. So the reality is that, right, for the Christians they say, oh, we have original sin, we're dirty, filthy, until Jesus comes. But I never liked that when I grew up and went to Catholic school. I said, I don't think that's necessarily true. They say a baby, when it's born, then it's not baptized, it's a, you know, dirty creature. That's what they say. If a baby dies before getting baptized, they say it goes to the nar, a baby. That never sit well with me. And then I started studying about Islam, it says the opposite. It says we're created on fitrah. We're pure. We're nafas ar-Rahman. We have the ruh, which is the most special thing Allah created. The heavens and the earth cannot contain me, but the heart of my believing slave can embrace me. So we're actually a noble creature, khulafa, created on the image of Allah, created in His own image. But then we fell to the lowest of the low. So we have both, right? That's why we can't look at any creature, a pig or this and that, and say, ugh, it's, because we have worse than that. Human beings much worse than that. And the great secret is that Allah had the angels bow to Adam. Because there's a secret in Adam that's even greater than the great angels. Sayyidina Jibreel, there's even a maqam that he said to Rasulullah, I can't go any further, you have to go alone. So the human being can be greater than the angels, but it can be less than the lowest of the low. And the secret is this nafs. This nafs. And you could really call Sufism, people try to say, oh, it's bid'ah, or they try to say it's a different religion. Reality, Sufism is like Islamic psychology. That's what it is. It's the study of the, you know, in Greek, the word psyche, it means the self, the soul. Psyche means soul. And ology is the study of. So psychology is the study of the soul. Of course, now in modern psychology, they've taken the psyche out of psychology. They say there is no soul. So what is it really? It's just nothing-ology. There's nothing. But if we understand what Rumi, when he talks about, right, he says the spirit. So if we understand psychology is study of the spirit, this is what Sufism is. And this is why you see so many problems in the Muslim world, because so many people try to say, take the study of the spirit out of Islam. But it's like taking the spirit out of a body. What happens? It's a corpse. You can't take tasawwuf out of Islam and still have Islam. It's yani a corpse. That's the reality. And so we wonder why we have places where there's so many, right, psychiatric patients in the ummah, like people that just not balanced and have so many issues because they took psychology out. They're imbalanced. They need a psychologist. That's what a traditional murshid is. It's just a psychologist. He's studying your soul. He's telling you, oh, I know what this is. I've been through this. You need to just do a little bit of this, a little bit of that. He's helping you. She's helping you. So, from the Quran, there's different levels of the nafs. And there's many levels. Some say 7, 11. There's different breakdowns, but the basic Quranic ones are 3. It's the nafs al-amara bisu, the nafs al-lawama, and the nafs mudma'ina. So the nafs al-amara bisu is the self that commands to evil. That's that lower self. Nafs al-lawama is then that self which it starts to call you to account. It starts to, no, you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't steal. No, that's not what you were created for. It starts to, it's what we call kind of now in modern terms, the conscience. It's your conscience. It's nafs al-lawam. And then the nafs al-mutma'ina is the soul at peace. Right? Because the nafs al-amara is pulling one way. Pulling to me, right? Smeagol, my precious, right? Me. I, my. It's just this constant nafs. It's really a miskeen, right? It's a sad thing when you see people that are totally me. It's like, subhanAllah. You're trapped in that. You're literally trapped. But we all have that still in us. And then the lawama is that side which is kind of fighting the battle of good, right? It's saying, no. Right? We need to be good. And that side gets stronger when you do good. Huh? There's a saying, I think the Native Americans have a saying, they said there's two wolves fighting inside of you. Right? There's a wolf of good and a wolf of bad. And they say, well, which wolf wins? They said, which one you feed the most? It gets stronger. So you do negative deeds, selfish deeds, you give in to the ana, right? The ananiya, right? It gets very strong. Right? You become like Donald Trump. La hawla wa la quwwata. But you be selfless and give and you do what's right and that gets stronger. Until the selfish voice becomes very quiet, like a little mouse. You don't even hear it. It's like, it has no power anymore. SubhanAllah, it's like as a hadith in which the Sahaba, the Prophet ﷺ said, every human being has a shaitan. And he also said, ﷺ, that shaitan flows through the veins of Bani Adam like blood. Prophet ﷺ said, every human being has a shaitan. They said, even you, Ya Rasulullah? He said, na'am. But mine has become Muslim. His shaitan made sajda. So it's like this nafs al-amara bisu, it can also be overcome. It can be defeated because this is the battle, right? This is the jihad, the greater jihad. And then once you win, then mudma'ina, you're at peace. There's no more war, right? So this is the spiritual path. This is what Islam really is about. So people say, okay, so how do we have overcome? The whole Islam, the deen is just the tools. That's all it is, right? You know, in the Hadith Qudsi, right? It talks about the awliya. Allah talks about those who harm my awliya. It's a big thing. Allah actually, to my knowledge, it's very few things Allah says He wages war against. One is those who deal in riba and interest. SubhanAllah. Look at the ummah. Now we say, oh, someone drinks wine, it's terrible, or they're the bad Muslim. But then everyone is dealing in riba. But Allah didn't say He wages war against people that drink wine. He said, about riba, what's worse? Allah help us, it's difficult. The Prophet ﷺ also said there'll be a time where everyone will deal in riba so much that even those who don't, they'll be covered in its dust. So we're all covered in its dust, that's the time. But in any case, you know, this is the reality, is that we are in this battle. And the deen, so he says, talks about the awliya, and then he says, my servant draws near to me by nothing more beloved to me than the obligatory. In other words, like the bare minimum, you start to draw near to Allah. And the secret of this drawing near is that Allah has different qualities. We all know the 99 names and the qualities, and like Habib was talking about, sight and hearing. So when you draw near to Allah, it's like you're being cloaked in His qualities, which means you're stripping away your I, me, right? Which is your false self anyway. It's illusory. Because all our existence and everything we have is from Allah. It's not. So when you're gentle, or you're kind, or you're honest, or you're truthful, right? All those words I just said, they're names of Allah, right? When you're gentle, latif. When you're good, when you're truthful, right? Al-Haq, Allah is the truth. So what you're doing is you're allowing, you could say, like your mirror, right? We talk about the mirror. You're cleansing your mirror so the divine qualities can just be reflected in you. There's no you. Then the mirror, you don't say, a true mirror, a good mirror, you don't see the mirror when you look, right? You just see what's reflected in the mirror. The only time you see the mirror is when the mirror is filthy. And then it's not reflected that well. It's dirty. There's all these spots on the mirror. Now you see the mirror, right? This is the human being. When the human being cleanses that mirror, all you see is the divine traits and attributes. That's why they say the Sufis are the fuqara. Because they realize they cleanse the mirror. It's just the divine names and attributes that you see when you see them, right? So they're saying, there's nothing for me, there's no me. It's just, right? As Rumi says, the glass takes on the color of the liquid poured in it. Imam Junaid said this too, right? So the idea is purifying the nafs, transforming the self, and this is what Islam is. And the bare minimum, the five daily prayers, the Ramadan, it will do that. Fasting, all these things, giving, charity, but then we do more. Supererogatory, right? He continues to draw near to me by what? By the supererogatory, by the extra, a little bit extra, right? Until I love him. The secret is love. Until I love him. And then what happens? When Allah loves you, then things happen. And when I love him, I become the eye with which he sees, the ear with which he hears, the hand with which he grasps, the foot with which he walks. I don't think the Wahhabis like that, Paul, that the hadith. It's a, yani, that's a very mystical hadith. This hadith is amazing. There's no Sufi that said something more mystical than what the Prophet said. This is the eye with which, right? He sees. I become the eye with which he sees. And Allah didn't say, he sees with my eye. He says, I become the eye with which he sees. Subhanallah. So how do we do this? This is the deen. This is what it is. So when you take out the spiritual heart of the deen, it just becomes rote things. And then it just becomes little nafs. You do all the actions, but your nafs is still very strong. Because you don't have the spiritual polish. And so then you say, you know, the story of the man, right? He was praying so much, praying. And he was just praying so people look at him. So proper, right? Habib cracked me up. He said, I don't dress like Arab. I mean, subhanAllah, what Habib have you seen wear all pink outfit, all pink jeans, cowboy hat? I love it. I love it because it's showing that the awliya come in all shapes and sizes. Please know that. So, right, what was I saying? The story.
Man standing in prayer.
Huh?
The man standing in prayer.
Yeah, the man standing in prayer. So there were some people, and he said, they were looking and said, Subhanallah. Look at how amazing his prayer is. And he was praying, he looked, he said, I'm fasting too. This is the nafs. If you just go through the motions but you take out the spiritual quality, you have some problems. Because in Medina, there were munafiqs. There were hypocrites. They were going through the motion. And the Prophet ﷺ said, he said, there will be people that will come. There's a lot of hadith about these people that they will pray so intensely, and you see their prayer, you'll feel ashamed of your own prayer. But they will be astray, and they won't have the essence. Allah forgive us. So the whole deen is about transforming the self. Because the only thing that veils us from reality, and Allah is reality, al-haq, is our self. And not our real self. That's the thing. It's not about yourself is bad, yourself, you just, we're all terrible. No, but we have that in us, but we also have, it's about uncovering that fitrah, that true self, that self that was in the garden, that nafas al-Rahman, that breath of the All-Merciful. So Rumi says a lot about this, and I wanted to just, we're going to take a break soon and come back for more. But first I wanted to recite just a few lines from Rumi about the self, and there's some amazing lines. Rumi said, quickly remove self from the midst so that you may grasp yourself in your embrace. So he uses self and self. So you could say self with a lowercase s and self with a capital S, right? So with the lowercase s, that's your false self. It's your true self. So you got to remove this false self so the real self can come, right? Like in the mirror, if it's all corroded, all you see is this filth, dirt. But you remove that, then you see the real self reflected in the mirror. He says, purify yourself from the attributes of self so that you may see your own true essence. He said, I and we are a stopper of mud and straw. Remove the stopper, like the cork, and behold that you yourself are a vat of wine. So this I and this we, it's like a, when you say I or this ana, it's like a cork that's stopping your true self. It can't come out. Just remove this I and it flows, right? And the wine flows. He says, self-existence brings terrible drunkenness. It removes intellect from the head and modesty from the heart. Lying in ambush, the intoxication of self-existence has waylaid 100,000 prior generations. Through it, a servant like Azazel became Iblis, saying, why should Adam be Lord over me? Right, it's me. That's why they say the first sin is Ana. Right? When Iblis inserted Ana into the divine presence. But me, I am better than him. This is the Iblisi way, Anania, right? On the other hand, we all are seeking, right, we talked about before, everyone's seeking freedom from themselves. They know that it's torment to be always me, 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 my thoughts, my this. So we seek it in different ways to get away from ourselves. Rumi says, everyone in the world flees from his own free will and existence to the side of drunkenness, right? They're seeking to be, right? Like the drunk man, he forgets his problems just for a night. And he wakes up, he has more problems, right? But just to forget that problem. So humans are like that. Maybe they don't drink. A lot of Muslims are like that. Maybe, okay, they don't drink alcohol, but they're escaping from their problems. They're not really. He says, striving to be free for an instant, people lay upon themselves the shame of wine and music. They all know that this existence is a snare, right? It's like a trap. I'm trapped in this existence. That volitional thought and memory are hell. They free from selfhood into selflessness, intoxication, and busyness, O well-guided man. So the opposite of selfishness is selflessness. And when you're selfless, then you can see the divine. So you could say selflessness is the goal, and selflessness is true selfhood in the highest sense, right? Capital S. Selflessness is the fitrah, right? He said, I have become senseless. I have fallen into selflessness. In absolute selflessness, how joyful I am with self. I will come to myself the instant I am obliterated and made selfless. I am complete only when outside the five senses and four elements. We have repented of our own self, and we will not leave this village. God calls, come out of your narrow abode. Our ultimate rendezvous will be at the monument near the sacred house. The translation of his words is this: come out of yourselves quickly, or else every instant will be a shackle. Every two paces, snares and traps. come out of ourselves, but to where? To selflessness. Selflessness is meaning, meaning. Self-consciousness is names, names. I love how he says, come out of your narrow abode, right? And I think, anybody like The Doors? I know Mehdar, got a true rock fan, right? The Doors, Jim Morrison, amazing poet. Anybody know what The Doors, the band, what it's short for, what they got their name? It's short for The Doors of Perception. And The Doors of Perception was a book written by Aldous Huxley, who was a very interesting man and was a spiritual seeker. And he took that from William Blake, a William Blake poem, The Doors of Perception. William Blake was one of the great English poets. He was a mystic. He was an amazing man. And he said, if the doors of perception were cleansed, everything would appear to man as it is, infinite. For man has closed himself up till he sees all things through narrow chinks in his cavern, right? Narrow little holes in his cavern, right? His narrow abode. So we're kind of trapped in this little cave that we've built. Because, and it's funny, you know, one of my teachers, he said, look, they say there's a secret of the relationship between Allah and Bani Adam, right? Right? The throne of the Ar-Rahman is the human heart. So, but then some, you know, people ask, they say, well, how, you know, in some, maybe Eastern mysticism, they say, I am God, you are God, these type of things. He said, my teacher said, no, we can't say that because, okay, maybe Ar-Rahman is at the center of your heart, but you're not at the center of your heart. You're outside and you have all this crusted, right? You have to take a pickaxe and get to the center of your heart. You're on the outside of your heart. You have to just chip away at it. Every day, five times a day, prayer, dhikr, remembrance. We're chipping away to get to the center of our heart. Allah make it easy. Mm-hmm. William Blake is amazing, though. He said, to see a world in a grain of sand and a heaven in a wildflower. To hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. Now that's a Sufi poem, right? He's talking about ayatullah, that it's all, right? He was tapped in. Allah gave him futuhat, mashallah. Rumi says, all eyes and ears are shut, except for the eyes and ears of those who have escaped from themselves. Right? Then I become the eye with which he sees, the ear with which he hears. I'm just going to close with a beautiful analogy, symbol, if we talk about this cavern. And then we'll all take a break, stretch, get some fresh air, and then we can come back shortly. But that is Plato's allegory of the cave. For those who were there last night, you heard me tell this. I wasn't a very good student, and so I really only remember one day of all of seventh grade school. Seventh grade, one day. And that was the day our teacher told us the story of Plato's allegory of the cave. Subhanallah. Because it hit me like, that's real. I know this is true. I don't know what it was, but it cracked through. It was like Allah was sending me a message. The summary of this allegory is that there's a group of people in a cave. And they were born in this cave and raised in this cave and lived their whole life in the cave. And they're seated and they're chained and they're facing the back cave wall. And they can't move. And they're chained so they can't move. But also their necks are yoked. Allah talks about the necks being yoked in Surah Yasin as well, right? The necks are yoked, so they can't turn left or right. They just see this one way, like blinders on a horse. And all that they see is the cave wall, and on this cave wall, it's the back of the cave wall, so there's just some shadows, that's it. But for them, that's the whole world. The whole world is just these shadows. They've never known anything else. So in the allegory, all of a sudden, one man finds himself free of his chains. And he can stand up, and he can turn his head, and he can move around the cave. And as he turns around, he finds that there's actually a light at the other end of the cave. And he looks and he realizes, oh, the shadows are just, they're coming from the light mixed with the darkness. And so he says, I want to investigate the light. So he goes closer and closer to the light. And he goes closer, it gets brighter and brighter until he steps into the light and it becomes blinding and overwhelming and overpowering and so beautiful but confusing. And then his eyes adjust. And he realizes he stepped outside of the cave. And he sees the rivers and the trees and the animals and plants and hears the birds and the beautiful sounds and the colors, infinitely more beautiful and more vast than the little cave that he thought was all of reality. And so after exploring for a certain amount of time, of course he wants to return to his people and tell them the good news, right? So he rushes back to his people and he tries to tell them, you'll never imagine. There's a world out there. This isn't all that there is. The shadows, they're actually projected from a light, and beyond the light, there's a world and there's colors, and he tries to explain. But they just look at him like, what are you talking about? And it's not really even their fault because they have no frame of reference. Their whole world is just shadows. So everything he's saying is just nonsense. It's like gibberish. And so at first they're just confused. What are you talking about? But he's insisting, no, you have to understand. You have to understand. And Plato says something amazing. He says, then at some point they switch from just being confused to actually hating this man. Because in the essence, he is challenging their very understanding of existence and their own very selves. He is undermining their whole worldview. And this is something very difficult for the human being. And so they turn against him. And when I heard that in seventh grade, I said, ah, that's real. That's us. We're in the cave, and there's a way out. I got to find it. And subhanAllah, now that I'm Muslim, this is such a beautiful allegory because it's haq. And it's interesting, you know, that the Arab philosophers, they used to call Plato Flatun Ilahi. Flatun is how you say Plato, and Ilahi is like divine Plato. Because they were like, he was tapped in. Even some of them, they thought maybe Socrates was a prophet. Socrates is Plato's teacher. So anyway, and Socrates is amazing, he died a martyr. It's an amazing story. But anyway, there's a lot of truth in what they say. And the prophets are the ones that got out of the cave. And they came back to their people and they said, listen, this isn't all there is. There's a world, there's a light out there, and the light, Nur, is making this whole world. And this world is a mix of light and dark, but there's a world infinitely greater than this. This is just a little cave. And what happened to most of the prophets? Their people hated them. They turned on them. They tried to kill them. They stoned them. They chased them out. Because it's difficult for the human being to have their worldview challenged, right? And the awliya, they're the true inheritors of the prophets. They got also out of the cave. But one of the problems of religion, we have to talk about it because this is a thing, and this happens with all the religions, is how do religions, every religion starts with someone getting out of the cave. They start with a prophet. Allah takes out of the cave. Jesus, Moses, Ibrahim, all of them. And the ones that we don't know, because Allah sent every nation a prophet. Was the Buddha a prophet? We don't know. It's possible. Did the Africans have prophets? Yes. Did the Europeans have prophets? Yes. Did the Native Americans have prophets? Absolutely. We may not know them, but our Prophet ﷺ confirmed them all and said every nation was set a prophet. Over 124,000, they say there's different narrations, but every nation was sent a prophet. So, but then what happens with the various religions is that the prophet teaches the way out of the cave. And he shows his companions how to get out. But then over time, people have to codify it. They have to make books and they have to teach and they have to create, you know, systems and hierarchies and stuff like that. And religions degenerate over time because human beings, right, they change them. And the human beings that change them are the ones that actually never got out of the cave. They're just talking about it, but they never experience outside of the cave. So then over time, it's just a bunch of people talking about outside of the cave that never been outside of the cave. They don't know what they're talking about, really. And then religions degenerate, and then Allah has to send a new messenger. But Allah said that, you know, the Prophet ﷺ is the final messenger of this cycle, right? Khatim al-Anbiya. But a lot of Muslims, you know, so there'll always be some people preserved in the ummah that have the whole way out of the cave. But there's other people that are talking a lot about the cave, but they're totally trapped in the cave. And so we ask Allah to make us people of insight and reality and attach us to the true inheritors of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and allow us to follow his way inwardly and outwardly in the most beautiful way, and to honor our teachers and to serve them, and to be amongst those who are truly Muhammadan and truly follow the prophetic way and truly embody the prophetic attributes and qualities, and to truly embrace the divine names and attributes inshallah in our beings. And we ask that Allah send peace and blessings upon our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ila hadrata Nabi al-Fatiha. Now I'm just going to offer a few reflections on his life and his legacy, because I feel like they're very important for us as Muslims in the modern world. First of all, I had the alhamdulillah blessed opportunity to spend Ramadan this year in Turkey with the Mevlevis. The Mevlevi order is the order that was founded by Mevlana Rumi and founded upon his way. And it's a beautiful order, as all the orders are. And of course, the Mevlevis are famous for the whirling ceremony, right? They're called the whirling dervishes in English. And they call this the Sama. And this is very central, actually, to Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi's life. In fact, all his poetry, a lot of people don't know this, but all his poetry was written to music and dhikr, basically. So he would sit at night and they would play music and they would basically have like a hadra, and then he would be inspired with these poems and he would recite them, and they would be written down by his students. So his chief disciple was named Husam ad-Din Chalabi, and he was the one actually who would sit night after night for months and actually years while Rumi dictated the Mesnevi to him. So he wrote it. Rumi told him the lines and Husam ad-Din wrote it. And when Rumi passed away, Allahyarhamuhu, Husam ad-Din became the Shaykh of the Tariqah. He became the head of the Tariqah. And then after him, it was Rumi's son, Sultan Valid. And this is important because the Mesnevi, being Rumi's magnum opus, is a unique book in human history. It's a poem, rhyming couplets, thousands and thousands of lines. It's longer than the Iliad and the Odyssey combined, and it's a commentary on the inner meanings of the Quran. And just in the way that the Quran, it's amazing, the Quran is actually, Islamic civilization basically is like a spiritual universe that is based upon a text, a revealed text. And every Islamic, you know, architecture, art, poetry, and individuals, every, you know, Islamic culture, they're really kind of like a commentary on the Quran. It's like the human being interfacing with this text. So it's a spiritual universe that's created around this. And the spiritual progress of the individual is also facilitated by this text. What's interesting about the Masnavi is it's a poem, written by a human being, that also created a spiritual civilization within the Islamic world. So what's fascinating about the Masnavi is in the Mevlevi order, your spiritual training, taking you through the maqams, the different levels, is based around this poem. So it's a poem that is actually used to train the disciples. And if you go to Rumi's tomb, it's for 800 years, 700 and some years before Ataturk shut it down, it was the living school of the Mevlevis. And they had hundreds of these khanaqas, or what they call zawiyas in Arabic, tekkes. And these were the place where the Mevlevi studied. And these institutions were very amazing. Amazing, right? Because in those days, every child memorized Quran in their madrasa, primary school, studied the basics of their deen. That was just normal, right? And Rumi actually says about that, he says, listen, in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the Quran came down piece by piece. And some of the Sahaba, they had only memorized small portions of the Quran. He said, but now in our time, every child has memorized the whole Quran. But who's better, us or the Sahaba? He says, so what is it? Like, why? If maybe one of them only, if I know more Quran than one of the Sahaba, what's the difference? SubhanAllah. Mawlana said, look, it's like if you go to a banquet, and there's so many types of food, plates of lamb and fish, and dishes you can't imagine, and different fruits and sweets and different courses. And you go there hungry, and you get a plate and you fill up your plate, right, like a mountain of food. And you're like, I can't wait to come back for more. But if you eat that plate, you're probably going to be too full to come back for more, right? Or perhaps, maybe you'll go back for seconds. But then at some point, you're just going to have to tap out. You can't take anymore. Rumi said, yeah, but if you go to the banquet and then you make a plate and you chew the food, but then you spit it out, you can keep eating forever. You never get full. And he said, for us in our time, the Quran hasn't passed our throats. We're just chewing it, but we're not actually digesting it. For the Sahaba, they took it into their beings and they were totally transformed by it. And all you need is a little bit. And you're totally nourished through and through. So, in the time of Mevlana, they had these Mevlevi khanes, which is where you would stay. And you would live there for 1,001 days. 1,001 days. And they had a full curriculum. And actually, what they would do to see if you wanted to come, you would come into the kitchen first. And you would take your shoes off and you would sit on this raised platform with your shoes facing where you're sitting. And you would have to sit there for 3 days and just observe the kitchen. And this is where the meals were cooked, but it was also where they would eat. And it was where some of the studies would go on as well. And you just observed. And at the end of those 3 days, you decided if you could live this life or not. And at any time during those 3 days, the sheikh was also observing you. And the sheikh was the chef, was the cook. Because the Mevlevi way is that you have to be a servant first and foremost. And that's the prophetic way anyway. And so if the sheikh noticed something in you just sitting silent, but if you notice this way isn't for you, he would just subtly take your shoes and point them the other direction, towards the door. Meaning, this isn't the life for you, this isn't the path for you. So after those 3 days, if you decided to take the path, then you would live there. Now what's amazing about this, amazing about their curriculum, is that you would study, you continue your Islamic studies, sure. But they were assuming, all the students that were entering, they had studied their basic, you know, fiqh, aqidah, memorized Quran, ahadith, and all these basic things. So This was a more, this was like the university. This was like a university, right? 1001 Days. And it was, in the realest sense, a liberal arts university. Because in addition to your basic, what we would consider Islamic studies, although they wouldn't have demarcated because it's all Islamic studies, you were going to study literature. Predominantly poetry, and predominantly the poetry of Mevlana Rumi. Predominantly the Masnavi, his masterwork. You were going to study it with masters, and they were going to teach you about the levels of yourself and the spiritual path through this. Then you were going to study music. So each person had to choose one instrument to study. The reed flute, the rabab, the duff, various instruments. And 1001 days you're studying that instrument. And of course, just like we talked about the ney and all the spiritual meanings, all of the instruments, they have spiritual symbolism. So you were studying it as a part of your spiritual training. And anybody who's learned an instrument, devoted themselves, knows it's a discipline. It is a spiritual training. And you would also study literature. We said literature, we said music. And then in this madrasa of Mawlana Jalaluddin Rumi, you would study dance. You would study dance. The sama. And don't think that the sama is just one movement, it's easy to learn. Because when I was in Turkey, I said, if I wanted to learn the sama to the Mevlevis, I asked them, I said, how long would it take? I said, if you stayed here, it would take about a year. I thought I could maybe learn it faster than that, but... And they said, that's if you study full-time, you could learn it in a year. Because there's great symbolism in it, and great subtlety in it. And so now, you know, we have discussion, and I don't know if you guys heard, but we taught in America, in my community where I live, we have Zaytuna College, mashallah, Allah bless the endeavor. And what's amazing is this, it's this conversation of the liberal arts academy, Islamic academy in the West. It's not a new thing, right? The Mevlevis had it. And of course, we're not even adding the fact that the central pillar of their study was service. And of course, during this 1001 days, the Shaykh would put you into khalwa for various periods, 40 days, this and that. And you had to serve in different things. In the kitchen was very central. You had to serve in the kitchen, you had to learn, you had to serve. And you know, it's interesting, they told me when I was there, they said the last year, the students that were the top, that were about to graduate, you know where they would have to serve? In the toilets. They had to clean the toilets. It was not the first year students, it's the graduates. Because that's the hardest on the nafs, right? And it's not like Western toilets now, it's easy, you just flush. No, I'm talking, some of you have seen more traditional toilets, it's difficult. It's hard on the nafs. Because the idea is like, okay, now you're a graduate, now you, right, you, mashallah, gonna get your diploma, you're gonna get your cap and gown. Which is actually, they gave them a cap and gown, because you've seen the Mevlevi hats, right? But the actual people that have completed the 1001 days, then they get to wrap the green turban around. They're called the post-neshin, the sheikh. And actually the cap and gown in Europe, in America, it comes from the Muslim world. It's the imama, and the jubbah, that's the cap and gown. Because in the Muslim world, that's what you would get. And interest, and you know, in universities, Cambridge and Oxford and Stanford and all the universities in the West, what do they call a professorship? They call it an endowed chair, a chair. That means there's finances to support a specific professorship on a specific subject. And that actually comes from the Islamic world too, because in the traditional universities in the Islamic world, there was a physical chair in the masjid, and that was the chair of the professor that taught this subject, whether he was the master of the Maliki madhab or the Shafi'i madhab or what have you. So these are interesting things. But the Mevlevis, you would get your cap and gown, and you had to, before you get that, clean the toilets. Oh, you think you're something now? You think you graduated? Let's make sure we obliterate that. The last aspects of the nafs. So the Sama ceremony is very central to the Mevlevis, and I was able to witness it, and I had witnessed it before, but when I was witnessing it with the Shaykh, and afterwards I was able to speak to him about it, I understood the profound symbolism. As you know, you've probably seen it, right? The dervishes, they wear the white, all white, and the white skirts, right? That they wore. Well, when they come in, they also have a black cloak over that. And then they have the turban that goes up. Even this has deep symbolism. So the white represents the funeral shroud, right? The kefin, which is where we get coffin in English. And it also represents the ruh, the spirit. And the cloak, it represents the body. And also represents the earth. So the body is wrapped in its kafan, and it's buried. And then the hat represents the gravestone, the tombstone. So this is like a ritualistic die before you die. They're literally wrapping themselves in their funeral shroud and going through a ceremonial enactment of their own death. Before the ceremony starts, they recite Quran, and the dervishes kneel on sheepskin, and the sheikh kneels in the center of the circle on a red sheepskin, which the red, it's dyed red, and it symbolizes the majesty and the jalal, the power of Allah, that the sheikh is upon. When the sheikh stands, the dervishes stand and they take off their black cloaks, right, to symbolize shedding the body. And now it's just the spirit, or the funeral shroud. And they stand like this, right, which symbolizes the corpse, but it also symbolizes a rose that has yet to bloom. And in Persian, the word for bloom is the same word for laugh. So in Persian, when you say a rose, the rose laughed, it means the rose bloomed. Beautiful language. They have, you know, just like the, you can tell what's important in a language by what they have many, many words for. And the Arabs have many words for camels and things. And the Persians, they have many words for flowers. It's all the Gulistan and all these. It's a very beautiful poetic language. It's a great secret in that language. But, so they come towards the Shaykh like this. And then they bow to the Shaykh. And the Shaykh kisses them on the turban. And then they step over an imaginary line. And they turn back towards the Shaykh and they bow again. Now the Shaykh is standing on an imaginary line in the center of the circle. And this imaginary line represents the line between life and death. The line between the seen and the unseen. The line between the heavens and the earth. The line between the day and the night. The line between all polarities. And the dervish is the one who's seeking to transcend, to die before he dies. And the Shaykh is literally straddling this line, symbolizing that the Shaykh has gone beyond, right? He has died before he died. He has embodied the secrets. He has embodied the polarities. And when, after the second bowing, once the dervish crosses over, he then will start to slowly unfurl his petals. And we've all seen, he has one hand to the sky and one hand to the earth. The right hand is facing the heavens, and the left hand is facing the earth. And with every turn, the dervish says, Allah, Allah, Allah. And this symbolism is that the human being is the Khalifa, and he's also the Abd. And so, the goal of the believer is to be a conduit for Allah's mercy, to be a vessel of this mercy. So this whirling is a prayer, oh Allah, make me a vessel for your mercy to enter this world. Just make me a servant of you so your mercy and your names and your attributes will flow through me into this world and I will be a servant of your creatures. They also, if you notice when they whirl, they keep their left foot still, and the right foot actually turns around the left foot. The left foot represents the Sharia, the sacred law. It's a pillar. And the right foot represents the Haqiqah, the spiritual realities that orbit around the Sharia. Right? That orbit around the Sharia. So, in the Mevlevi order, they had these dervish houses all over the Islamic world, especially the Ottoman Empire, but they had them, they were also large ones in places like Damascus and Aleppo and Cairo. And people would be trained in the Mesnevi, in this poem. And it took many years. So the 1,001 days, that's just the basic university. Then if you wanted to go on, you know, like graduate school, basically. So it's just... And the people that mastered the Mesnevi with an unbroken chain back to Rumi himself, they were called Mesnevi Khans, the masters of the Mesnevi. And they would go out to all these tekes, and they would take the murids through the spiritual path using a poem. And it's just so beautiful that art and poetry is such a central aspect of the ummah. You know, Abu Bakr Siraj al-Din, Martin Lings, said something amazing. He said, Allah chose to reveal the final religion to a tribe of warrior poets. Amazing, the Quraysh, they were all warriors. There was no male who was not a warrior. And there was no male or female that was not a poet. Amazing, right? And if you didn't write your own lines of poetry, you would still memorize thousands and thousands and thousands of lines. When people that know that this type of tradition in predominantly oral cultures exist to this day in places like West Africa, where people memorize thousands and thousands and thousands of lines of poetry, mashallah. And the Quraysh were like that. And Allah was preparing them for the Quran. They were people that appreciated language and were moved by language and were transformed by language and felt language. Even, you know, Sheikh Hamza mentioned that in Mauritania, when they hear a line of poetry that they feel, they actually go, oh! Like they make an audible noise, like getting punched, actually. And we say in English too, right? Oh, that hit me. Like it hits you. You know, you literally feel it. And there's a lot of symbolism about shi'r, poetry, and the meanings of shi'r, and the subtleties, because it's related to feel. But the idea of poetry is really that the poets are those that dive deep into the human state, into the heart, into the ocean of La ilaha illallah. And then they bring up the pearls to the surface for those that haven't developed the lung capacity to dive so deep so that they can experience them. You see? So, mashallah, tabarakallah. These are some things about Mawlana Jalaluddin Rumi and his legacy which I wanted to share with you all. And one of the most beautiful things about Mawlana Jalaluddin Rumi is that he understood that in the final period especially, the most important thing to emphasize is the path of love and the path of rahmah, especially in our times. And that's why we're so honored to be here at the University of Life, because don't you just feel that you're in like a womb of love here, mashallah. So may Habib, may Allah bless you for what you've created. You know, one of my teachers told me, he said, when you go into a space that someone's created, you know, maybe it's a zawiya that a sheikh has created, or maybe it's just someone's home, maybe it's any special place, he said, the places that people create is really just the extension of their heart. The physical places that people build, they're showing you what's in their heart. So now we have modern cities with they're ugly, right? they're so dehumanizing and they're just metal and they're so tall, and it's like, it's just coming out of what's in the modern people's heart. But when you're in a place and you feel love and you feel healing and you feel embraced and you feel like you can just be and come with whatever state you're in, and you can have your state raised and you can be purified, know that that's just the heart of that individual that created that space that you've just entered into, mashallah, tabarakallah. So, alhamdulillah, Habib, thank you for letting us in your heart.